I like it. So much better than the boom.
Oh, it's so much better.
Welcome back to Sikistan from the center of the bustling metropolis that is St. Sikisburg. Someone put out the argument that we should probably call it Stagistan, but Dara thinks we should annex a country called Stagistan.
I think we might just have a little dalliance into Stagistan every so often.
Hostile takeover of Stagistan. It's kind of like San Marino in Italy. It's just like a little country in the middle of nowhere. So basically, we're going to go with St. Sikisburg, and hopefully Alex will come up with something cool for a t-shirt on that, the next graphic run.
Yeah.
But today's video, we're talking about the three tiers of doping in CrossFit, or how we kind of segment it out into how people were or are currently using performance-enhancing drugs in CrossFit and avoiding or not avoiding drug tests, as the case may be. Now, some of you probably would have seen the video we did the other week where we talked about, let's talk about the dominance of Chinese weightlifting. Mostly, people are very, very positive with that. Of course, you always get the hyper defensive non-Chinese and sometimes Chinese nationals aggressively attacking us on a personal level, even though we said we'd no stakes in this. And we didn't even talk about the Chinese weightlifting that much.
No.
That was literally just a headline to get people interested in the video. It was across all sports in the Olympics in terms of that video. But that was just kind of the thing that set us off at the time to talk about that. And so mostly people were very, very positive of that. Then you get those one or two, which I didn't know were called the Wu Mao Army, I think, which is like Chinese people who like aggressively defend any kind of negative view of Chinese online. And we're going to stop talking about this now because YouTube will aggressively attack us as well.
Right. Moving from one cult into another, we're going to talk about like these different tiers of possible doping in CrossFit, or highly probable doping in CrossFit. The first group we're going to talk about today is the person you probably know right now if you train in a CrossFit gym or you have trained in a CrossFit gym.
Minimum of 5 in every CrossFit gym, I would say. Minimum.
Yeah, I'd say between 2 and 10.
Wait, 1 per like 80 members, I feel like would be a good system.
Okay, yeah, 1 per, yeah, 1 yeah. per 50 members.
1 per 50 members.
So this is a non-professional athlete, usually not even that interested in competing, or maybe they are interested in competing, a lot of the time coaching in the gym, and they are just like recreationally, they want to be better at CrossFit, so they'll dope to get there. There's absolutely nothing wrong with it. This is absolutely the kind of freest form at the moment, like outside of bodybuilding, if you're looking at actual performance-driven sport, this is the kind of freest and like most honest form of doping there is at the moment, right? You don't have a federation, you don't have a national team, you don't have an anti-doping board kind of falling over you like WADA or something, and you don't have this kind of higher level of competition aside the kind of CrossFit games and the associated sectionals with those. So there's a number of things which set this apart. Usually when we talk about doping or athletes who are doping, they're professional athletes and they're being brought through it by coaches. They're being guided kind of through the process. There's usually a system whereby as younger athletes are brought in, then as they develop, they have a certain level of alternative drug use. And then as they get into adulthood, that kind of progresses with them. In this case, most of these athletes are between the ages of 20 and 35, I would say. And they're just taking drugs because they'll never ever get drug tested and they want to be the best possible person they are at their sport.
So a lot of these kind of tier one CrossFit dopers, generally the idea with these people is they wouldn't even entertain the idea that they would ever get drug tested. It's not even a remote possibility that they would get drug tested because they would already be in national or regional events. Now, some of these CrossFitters will actually end up getting into international events, maybe sanctional events, maybe broader international events that are not sanctionals but would still have some drug testing. For example, Italy, if there's an Italian CrossFit competition on, for example, there has actually been cases where the WADA have shown up to test the CrossFitters at the Italian showdown, for example, or whatever they'll call it. So very oftentimes some of these tier one dopers are athletes who will never get drug tested. But some of these athletes are ones who actually hope to reach the level of games, but never even fathom the idea that they will ever get drug tested. Or they'll only literally think about it when the drug testers show up to the competition and they're like, oh, fuck, there's drug testing in CrossFit. So these tier one, it's kind of funny. It's such an innocent view of doping because for anyone doping in any Olympic sport, you'd always be like, oh, my God, what if I get drug tested? It'd be something that would play on someone's mind the whole time they are doping and for long after. Whereas with these kind of tier one CrossFitters, it's literally like, fuck, I might get drug tested at some stage 5 minutes before they get drug tested. But for the rest of the time, it's something they would never even fathom. The idea of metabolites, for example, testing times, you know, what should I take based on what I might get tested, doesn't even enter the realms of possibility for these tier one dopers. It's kind of like a cute puppy almost.
Yeah, I think there, it's a unique situation as well. In the last decade, you have this huge access to drugs that was never in existence before, but also you have access to really strong compounds that don't have great kind of track records or don't have any track records at all.
Mm-hmm.
And then people get them like SARMs, and they'll get them in an eyedropper, and then they'll say, Asher, this is barely doping.
How do you know they're an eyedropper, Darren?
Because you get ads on your laptop every single week from them.
It's usually a minimum of three different compounds as well. It's always like, it's not like ever, they're like, okay, I'll just take Endurable or like Cardiine or whatever. They'll be like, minimum of three different things. Sometimes they'll take things that are doing the same thing, and they'll just take just multiple.
Compounding.
Just for no reason. Like, they'll just take a variety of different things because in their head, they're not like, okay, so there's no like minimum effective dosage, or there's no like smart drug selection. It's literally like, fuck it, I'm taking SARM, so I just might use everything. Throw the kitchen sink at it.
Before we move on to the next group, we would just like to say that this is in many ways where the kind of modernist view of like, just leave people off. If you watch Clarence's videos, Clarence's reactions to Weightlifting House's videos, a lot of what Clarence is saying there is like, leave adults make their own decisions. And like, all power to them. All these people in this group, they're usually well into adulthood. By the time any of this starts off, they're usually making the decision for themselves. There's very rarely financial or monetary gain from them winning competitions. So it is just like, I like doing CrossFit. I like being better at CrossFit, and drugs help me get there.
So
you were just
talking. Oh, it's just my turn.
Go on, you go then.
No, what were you gonna say?
That's grand.
Did you go intro? Like, I did, yeah. Oh, I'm going for it.
No,
go for it if you have
no,
it's good.
No, it's fine. Go on, we'll use there. Because it's not going to be that good now that I said it.
So, moving on to tier two. These are very, very similar to tier two from the previous one we did on, for example, Olympic caliber athletes. These are athletes who have a professional financial stake at stake. That was not right.
They have a stake in the game.
They have. These are athletes who are essentially semi-professionals, hoping to become professional athletes, or have some kind of financial stake. They're maybe sponsored by big companies. They want to continue to compete at the games or regional events, or they're hoping to get to the games, for example. So they understand that they could be drug tested. They understand that getting a positive test in their name would be very, very bad for their career. Not only their career in the sport, but also their career in terms of like sponsorship. So these are athletes who certainly cannot, for their own sake, become a positive case in CrossFit.
Yeah, I think when you look at this group, you're talking about the games athletes. You're talking about top 20 in the open in your country, depending on obviously the country you're in. But these are the kind of full-timers, right? They might not be full-time just athletes. They might be a gym owner or a coach in a big gym, but they're basically full-time athletes and full-time training. When you do look at this group, though, there is the kind of this misnomer that it's only certain people in CrossFit are doping. Only certain groups within those kind of gyms might be doping. You have to look at like the where there's smoke, there's fire, and where there is any amount of like success or any amount of perseverance in the sport for a long time. You have to just assume that in a sport that is completely performance driven, they have to have performance across a large number of factors. It's basically a sport made for drug taking. So if you're looking at people who qualified for the games since, you could probably say 2009 or 2010, I would be fairly happy at saying like more than 90% of those people who qualified were enhanced at the time of qualification and probably enhanced at the time of competition as well.
So again, these are athletes who will make efforts to outsource their intelligence to help them pass drug tests. In terms of that intelligence, passing a drug test for CrossFit, for example, would be so much simpler than, for example, passing a WADA drug test. So very often, the drug test from CrossFit HQ, there is typically a 24-hour notice for a drug test. They wouldn't really be signed up to any Adams. They would just be a CrossFit athlete, and they'd be contacted to say someone is going to come and drug test them the day later. Now, sometimes we talk about this online, people are like, oh, that's easy for someone like if a couple of hours notice is a huge benefit. Now, depending on what you're doing, it can be a huge benefit. So assuming you've outsourced this to someone who knows what they're doing, a whole day's notice is hugely beneficial for those. Now, again, it's not something incredibly simple. For someone with no experience, who has no idea what they're doing, that extra day's notice is of no use to them, for essentially, other than the fact that if they don't show up, that's the only way they wouldn't fail that drug test. But for someone who knows what they're doing, a day's notice, they'd probably be taking stuff with the assumption that they might be drug tested on a day's notice, and then would enact a business continuity plan where they would not test positive that following day. Funny story about the drug testing CrossFit. There, at one stage, there was a CrossFitter who got his friend. Now, also, I believe to a certain time, they actually didn't go into the toilet and watch you. So for anyone who has ever been drug tested, I've probably been drug tested maybe about 10 times over the course of my weightlifting career. And basically what happens is someone comes in and watches you piss. Yeah. Like, full on, just literally
staring. Sometimes we practice it.
Sometimes they'll come in, they'll watch you piss. They'll make small talk with you and say, like, so what are you doing in college while you're mega dehydrated, your adrenaline is crashing, and you're trying to produce a sample you're in the toilet with them, oftentimes very, very small toilet, depending where you are. They're trying to make small talk while watching your bits and bobs, depending on who you are. This doesn't happen in CrossFit, thank God, and I'm glad there's no one trying to make small talk while they're watching the piss. So essentially, there was a dude who got his friend to take the drug test for him, but his friend didn't tell him he was also on drugs and he tested positive.
Oh my God.
And so the story was that it came out after that his friend actually took the test for him. But your man also was basically admitting at the time that he was also on drugs. Otherwise, yeah, why would he have got his friend to do that? So if anyone can find that case and post in the comments, that would be pretty funny.
That's hilarious.
So basically, that's our tier two. These are people who try and avoid drug tests. It's a little bit simpler for them. I'd say it's a lot simpler for them. And they make their best efforts to avoid this drug test either by insourcing or outsourcing their knowledge from this.
The last tier then is tier three. And you're talking about a very, very select group of athletes that sit within this. These are basically athletes who it will be very, very, very bad for CrossFit if they get popped. So you're talking about...
Don't say any names.
You're talking about winners. You're talking about very, very strong personalities within the community. And CrossFit basically have the ability to shield these people from a positive drug test ever coming out, right? So if you have... If you have...
Someone accused us last time and said, do we accuse Matt Fraser? And we... No. We accuse Schmatch Major.
Yeah.
An imaginary individual. We didn't say anyone's name.
Yeah. But anyway, there's individuals within the sport who everybody could see. There's probably 10 to 20 of these individuals who are both household names in the CrossFit community, but are also now kind of widespread within the fitness community, who it would be incredibly bad for CrossFit if they got popped and it came out that they were doping. In this case, they're probably in their own head living within tier two, right? So they're doing their outsourcing, they're selecting compounds effectively, they're ensuring that they'll be cycled out of their system by the time they get to competition. But the reality of it is that if they get tested at competition, that test will never see the light of day, because CrossFit fully controls the testing company, fully controls the entire rhetoric and all the press releases that are made around the test, and they also control all the coding which goes with each sample. So it's impossible that a test like that would ever come out.
So the interesting thing about this is that both parties may never actually discuss this dynamic that they've gone on. So from CrossFit's point of view, they would of course never give an athlete ammunition to oust them in the future. So they would never explicitly say to them, they would never have, you know, correspondence to them saying that, don't worry about it, we're not going to positive test you regardless of what your test shows. They would very, very likely just ensure that it never happens from a point of view that, well, it would make no sense for them to do this. But they would also ensure that they're always protecting the company and never really giving that athlete evidence to in future oust them if they ever so fell from grace. Then from the athlete's point of view, it makes sense not to ever kind of have that kind of, give that kind of power to CrossFit Inc., for example, or CrossFit HQ. They would never, it would be smart of those athletes to avoid drug testing via kind of per particular drug selection or smart biochemistry to always ensure that their tests would always be clean. Otherwise, you'd be giving a kind of anonymous body, the CrossFit, the company, always ammunition against you in turn to kind of oust you if you ever fell from grace or did something they didn't really approve of or they wanted to play a particular game. So it makes sense for both parties to not ever kind of really discuss this. Now, it certainly could happen, but from the outside point of view, it would make most sense for everyone to not ever actually talk about this. Now, just want to say that we're obviously not accusing anyone of doping in CrossFit in particular. No, certainly not. We're not accusing anyone of a sport where it requires you to do multiple different variety of domains, which typically have things and skills and biochemistry that usually involve things that would not be possible for someone who's not taking drugs to adapt sufficiently to the levels they get to. Certainly not accusing any athlete of that.
No.
And certainly not accusing people who could potentially do that, but only with the use of performance enhancing drugs. Otherwise, it would simply be impossible for their biochemistry to adapt to a sufficient level unless they're an absolute freak. And it's probably unlikely, given that CrossFit's quite a niche sport. And are we assuming that maybe those 50 people at the games are all one in a million athletes? Probably no. I don't know. Who could know? Who can say?
Even if they are,
who can say?
Even if they are, everyone you consider to be a one in a million athlete is on drugs anyway.
Holy shit!
Yeah, but it is. I think it's an interesting case. I like talking about it because this happens in other sports, like the kind of privatization of drug testing within an organization and a corporation controlling that kind of rhetoric over who gets popped and who doesn't get popped. It's happened multiple times in the past. There's loads of different cases that have come out over the years in cycling, in baseball, in swimming. Loads of these where you get federations controlling that kind of rhetoric, weightlifting, obviously. And I think it kind of happens in CrossFit under the guise of a drug-tested sport.
My favorite thing was that documentary where Ricky Gerrard had tested positive. And all the other people, I'm not going to say who, obviously.
Yeah. But
it's funny, loads of different people are like, oh, it's terrible he's taking drugs. Like, you can take drugs, I don't need them.
Yeah.
And it's like, this is... But actually, the funniest part, it was comical from my point of view, but it's funny because there's all the CrossFitters being like, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's dead right.
Yeah.
So I hope you enjoyed this kind of video. If you like us when you talk about doping videos, let us know in the comments if there's any aspect of doping you'd like us to talk about other than giving you advice about drugs. Obviously, we haven't the fucking clue. But we could maybe get someone back on, or you could just always go check out someone like Roger Chavez, Team AVS, GSP. We've done some podcasts with him if you're looking for that. But again, if you like the kind of discussions around doping rather than the how-tos around doping, I suppose, or the nuances of doping in sport, maybe. If you like that, if you need ideas, anything subject you'd like to hear us talk about from a theoretical point of view, we're happy to make these videos because they get great views.
They really do.
Great views for the algorithm.
If you're a CrossFitter, you want to get stronger and better at your lifting, go and check out the CrossFit strength training programs. They're 4 days a week. They get everything from your Olympic lifts to your power lifts to your accessory work and some gymnastic skills. Go and check them out. They're on the website.
We also got the Blue Yeti, which is a new mic. Hopefully you can't hear Fitz's incredibly loud breathing. Like, I know loads of people were like, oh my God, Fitz is breathing so loud. So we purposely got this one.
Loads of people.
And loads, there were doubles of people, twos and threes of people.
So we have a little dildo spaceship on our desk now.
It does look like a spaceship, actually.
Yeah.
So let us know if the quality is better, and we'll see. It's a lot easier for you to use. Yeah. Thanks for watching.
Now look, you didn't even fall asleep.